It's a little blurry. Like, the idea for the book came when I was still living, as you may mention, partly in London and partly in New York. And I was doing a very cliche thing of searching for myself. And I wondered, and I realized actually that for a Singaporean, for a Southeast Asian, I actually don't know very much about Southeast Asia at all. We seem to actually sometimes, I think, be very embarrassed by the fact that we're part of the region and we're part of Southeast Asia. So in 2013, when I knew that I was actually moving back to Singapore from New York City, I decided that I wanted to go on a journey of discovery of Southeast Asia. But I wasn't just going to do it any other way. I would go and do it on my own terms, which is, you know, to have a bit of the hard work as well as a bit of the luxury in the grand hotels. And so this is a very interesting map, which I bought. It's a map of the region in 1895. It's interesting because it shows that Southeast Asia was split into six colonial empires. I very quickly realized that if I was going to find out more about what modern Southeast Asia was about, it is inevitable to go into the history of to colonial history in Southeast Asia. And so as you can see, the region was split into territories owned by Britain, France, Spain, the Netherlands, Portugal, and surprisingly, Germany. And 1898 was a tipping point. Because the 20 years between 1898 and 1917 changed the boundaries of Southeast Asia and fixed them to what they are today. So in 1898, what happened was the Americans won the Spanish-American War, and so the Philippines shifted hands from Spain to America. And then in 1917, World War I ended, and the Germans gave up their colonies in Southeast Asia. And Southeast Asia, as we know today, is still, you know, it's still, the boundaries of Southeast Asia are still governed by these colonial territorial boundaries. Anyways, that was very serious. But so this is what the book takes you through. It simulates a journey by ship, since it's about travel in the 1920s, through the region in a way that, you know, tourists in the time could have taken it. So it goes from Rangoon, today's Yangon, to the straight settlement cities of Penang, Malacca, and Singapore, down to the Dutch East Indies, cities of Batavia, today's Jakarta, and Surabaya, back up to Bangkok, which was never colonized, but it came very close to being colonized by the French. And then on downwards to French Indochina, for the cities of Saigon, Phnom Penh, and Hanoi, east to Manila, and we end up in Hong Kong, so that we have a feet in British India, and also sort of like a 1 foot in British India, 1 foot in China. So what was I doing, or what was my intent in each of the cities? This is one of my favorite images. I don't think it's actually in the book, but so what I was doing in each of these cities was I was walking for hours and hours and hours in the old town with my camera, searching for traces of the past that remained in the present. And so this is a very interesting image. It is a stained glass window in the former Yavasha Bank, the Java Bank in the city of Batavia, today's Jakarta, the old town of Batavia. And I was walking to this bank building, and this suddenly just stood out at me. And this was interesting to me because it spoke very eloquently of the philosophy behind the Dutch colonial empire. I mean, look at this. This is the Roman god Mercury. And so in a way, it was almost like saying that the Dutch, us, we are the new Romans. We are here, and we're building a new world, and we're sort of harking back to the Roman Empire of old. And also, if you know, stained glass is a religious genre. But here, it is used towards images of empire and commerce. So in a way, you can read it as being very solipsistic, you know. We are worshipping ourselves as the colonial master, or we are worshipping trade. These, of course, are the coat of arms of the three major cities in the Dutch East Indies, Batavia, Jakarta, Semarang, and today Surabaya. And then another reason why I found these really moving was because, and every time these popped out at me, I felt goosebumps on my arms, because it's like a traces of a lost civilization. And you know, in a way, you kind of don't need to go too far to look for these traces. I mean, it's all around us. There was an entire civilization that was here before, and you know, it may not have been a good experience, but they're lost, and it's things like these that provide us with a sense of how life is so completely different just 70 years ago. So similarly, this image, this is the Manila Cathedral in the walled city of Intramuros in Manila. The walled city was built by the Spanish in the 1500s, and it was ruined largely by World War II. But if you walk the city today, it's such a contrast because there's slums in the city, but then you look up and there's this, which sort of again throws you back to like the, you know, the 16th century, which was this, when this was built. And again, it speaks very strongly of what the Spanish Empire was about. It was trade, definitely, but largely religion. Okay, so after I did all the traveling, which actually took me about a year, I shopped my book proposal around, and very happily, Talisman actually picked me up. And then the process of rediscovery began. So that was when I started really doing research and also sort of acquiring archival material for the book. And I was very happy to be able to tap into Mr. John Coe's amazing collection of travel-related ephemera. The National Museum and the Singapore Philatelic Museum also has some pieces that made it into the book. But in large part, I actually bought most of this stuff. So this is one thing that I actually bought. This is a print, 1888 print of the Batavia Statos, or a city hall, from a, you know, it's a folio of these lithographic prints that was done at the time. And what you see, I'll show the next slide. One of the best things about having archival material and contemporary photography is then I can do a lot of these then and now shots, which some of which also occur in the book. So this is what it is today. It still stands. It is relatively well preserved. It is today's Jakarta History Museum. It has a wonderful collection of furniture from the Dutch colonial era. Another favorite shot of mine is this. This is a shot of Raffles Place in Singapore. And the building in the middle right here is the former Chartered Bank of India, Australia, and China, which is the forerunner of today's Standard Chartered Bank. As you can see, it's got a neoclassical sort of design. And this building right here is John Little, which is sort of Spanish, Iberian, Moorish kind of architecture. And of course, this is what it looks like today, more or less. Almost the same angle, right? The Standard Chartered Bank is here. It's about the same spot it has always stood. So this was built, the original building was demolished in 1981. This is what stands today. And the MRT station for Raffles Place is actually designed after the architecture of John Little. Another lovely shot, Hong Kong Harbor in the early 1900s, and what it looks like today. Very, very, very different. okay, so what did I actually learn from this? I think the benefit of doing all these cities is then being able to compare and contrast. And I managed to do this with archival material as well as with photography. And I learned a lot in terms of how the various European colonials designed their cities. So the Portuguese and the Spanish designed their cities as medieval fortresses, walled fortresses, because they were here so much earlier, from the 1500s and 1600s. The Dutch built their cities sort of long and sprawling across the central axis because they had a very stupid idea, sorry, there are no Dutch people today, of building canals that went malaria, you know, that were infested by malaria, and then they moved further up, and then they were, you know, with more canals, and they were infested by malaria again, and so they had to move. The French, they built their cities on one essence alone, la civilisation. So their cities was, you know, the centerpiece of the cities was always this sort of upper house. And then, of course, the British, it was all about, you know, the cities were monumental. It spoke of commerce and trade and the might of the British Empire, which was the biggest empire at the time. So what else did I learn? I also figured out some of the similarities. So Singapore, I found out, doesn't have quite have the pattern on multicultural. Actually, most, if not all, of the port cities I went to were multicultural to a certain degree, especially the cities of the British Empire. So this is Rangoon, today's Yangon, the old town in Rangoon, and as you can see, it is all the trappings of Singapore. You know, Hindu temples, Chinese temples, synagogue, churches of various different denominations, Shia and Sunni mosques, and so on. And you will find this to a smaller extent even in Saigon, today's Ho Chi Minh City, where there is also sort of a Hindu temple and a mosque and so on. What else? There's also a similarity beyond the colonial architecture and the vernacular architecture. Shop houses, the traditional shop house, vernacular is found in all of these port cities, because in all of these port cities there were resident Chinese communities trading, and they've been there for years, since the Europeans came. So this, of course, everyone knows is in Malacca. This is in Hanoi, Hanoi Old Town. I mean, there are variations on the architecture, but the essence is the same. And this is Phnom Penh, the cafe, the sort of boutique cafe quarter, the Holland Village of Phnom Penh. And of course, the other thing that all the cities had was this grand colonial hotel that was the center of the social scene in the city. It's historic, it played a very important role in the histories of all of these cities, and it played host to celebrities, to heads of state, to nobility, and to anyone who really wanted a taste of what it was like to travel long distance in the 1920s. And so the book features 10 grand hotels, 2 historic, not quite grand, hotels, and 1, sorry, 10 grand hotels that still exist today, 2 historic hotels that still exist, and 1 grand hotel that has been demolished. These are the Strand Hotel in Rangoon, the Eastern Oriental Hotel in Penang, the Majestic Hotel in Malacca, it's not featured here, that's not in this slide, the Raffles Hotel, of course, the Hotel des Andes in Batavia, this has been demolished, and actually sadly replaced with the Kafu. And Kafu stands there today. The Oriental Hotel in Bangkok, today's Mandarin Oriental. The hotel, the Orania Hotel in Surabaya, also held by the Sakis brothers, but by the son of the original Sakis brothers. Today it's called Hotel Majapahit. The Continental Hotel, Hotel Continental in Saigon. The Hotel Royal in Phnom Penh is actually my favorite hotel of all, and my favorite city of this journey. The Hotel Metropole in Hanoi, my second favorite hotel. And the Manila Hotel in Manila, it ends up with the reader and myself having high tea in this fabulous, grand lobby space of the Peninsula Hotel in Hong Kong. And so, what's next? For publicity for the book, I've started a new blog called romanceofthegrandtour.com, as well as the Facebook page for this. And in the course of the year, I'll be putting up images that are in the book or did not make it in the book, events and so on, really to drive publicity and sales for the book. In the meantime, also working with the publisher to see if we cannot do a mini grand tour of some of the cities and the hotels that are featured, and we're hoping to go to Phnom Penh and Bangkok for a start. In the meantime, actually, the grand tour is a multi-year, multi-city project. I have not stopped traveling. I stopped traveling the day I started submitting my proposal to the various publishers. But in the course of the 2 years it took to actually put the book together, I continued. So from Hong Kong, I went on to the treaty ports of China and Japan, these legendary cities, Shanghai, Qingdao, Tianjin, Amoy, Canton, and so on, Nagasaki, Yokohama, and I've actually finished travel for this. I'm actually into India right now, which is the third part of my book. If you read last Sunday's Straits Sunday Times, you know there's an article of me in Calcutta. But so I guess my point for this is that, you know, I would like to encourage everybody, to encourage people you know to buy the book. Because if sales do not work out, this will never see the light of day. Please, please drive sales to me, and thank you very much. I have a last slide, but before that, I think I would like to do something very important, which is to thank people who have giving me this opportunity. I would first like to thank my publisher, Mr. Ian Pringle. He's not, unfortunately not here today because I mentioned he's in London right now. It's an interesting story. I want to thank you for the opportunity to do this, for giving me the book contract. The interesting story is that because he's so English and so crusty, I'm sorry, no time. For about 10 minutes after he offered me the deal, I thought he did not. Because he was so mean, he was like, and so I thought, okay, I've done this, I've gone through like 6 publishers, I can deal with rejection. You know, I'm just gonna say, oh, thank you so much, you know, for yada yada. And then 10 minutes into it, like, hang on, did you say you were not going to do it, or you were going to do it? And I found out that we were going to do it, and I was so happy that day. I came back and I hugged Jane, my colleague Jane. I would like to thank my editor, such a nice ring to it, my editor, Ms. Kim Inglis, who always looks fabulous, and who really pushed me really hard to write better, and to sort of, you know, think and work in evocative ways to present, I think, sometimes very ordinary scenes on the street. And I think it's due to her that the volume is this top and this sort of efficient in conveying the essence of what I tried to convey. Thank you. I would like to thank Noreha, Steffi, Chi-Ying, and the design team in Talisman Publishing. Oh, they're behind. Thank you so much for making such a beautiful, beautiful book. And thank you for bearing with all the emails that I sent at midnight, you know, because I have a full-time job. So I have to work after I get home from work to sort of revert back to you. I would also like to thank Janice for sort of managing this project, managing the studio. Janice, thank you so much. And of course, I'd like to thank Amna and the APD Singapore team, the distributors for the book, for putting the book out there. I understand that more than 1,500 copies have been pre-ordered. And also for organizing this fabulous event today. They literally came and they put everything up. So thank you so much, Amna and the APD Singapore team. Thank you. Next, I would like to thank the collectors that I had the opportunity to work with. First and foremost of which is Mr. John Coe, who unfortunately would have been my guest of honor, but he is in Boston right now. And I have to take this up because he said that I have to say something on his behalf. So let me just find what I have to say. So I would like to thank Mr. John Coe really for the inspiration. I mean, it was really his amazing collection that inspired me to sort of write about the history of travel, something that's very fascinating and something that's not quite well researched, perhaps. He has tons of stuff. So this is what he said: I'm supposed to convey how happy he is that the junk he collected found expression in your book. It is not junk. He's got an amazing collection of the century travel brochures and maps and postcards, and stuff, many of which actually found their way into the book. I would like to thank Mr. Kosao Chan, Ms. Ilse Sharp, and Mr. Jan Venendong for the use of some of the images in this book. Mr. Kosao Chan has a collection of postcards on Indochina in the Singapore Philatelic Museum, which I actually used. I would like to thank the National Museum of Singapore and my colleague, Ms. Angelita Chiu, Ms. Tan Chok Kun, who had to ding-dong back and forth with me and some of the images that I wanted to use in the book, and very kindly waived the fees for the use of the images in return for the content in this book actually being used in the museum and its publications. I would like to thank Ms. Maylin from the Singapore Philatelic Museum, Tress and Lucille, I'm sure they're here, they have left, also were sitting for hours in the museum, listening to me ramble on while I had picked out these postcards from thousands of postcards that I wanted to use. Finally, I think I would like to thank my colleagues, Ms. Jane Binks, Ms. Jennifer Yin, Ms. Wendy Ong, my colleagues in the finance, procurement and planning division for listening to me, you know, go on and on and on and on and on, and Mr. Alvin Tan, on and on and on and on and on. For the last 2 years, I've been working on this, that I had this book contract on this project, and for also sort of co-sponsoring the wine and helping today and helping out with this event. And finally, most importantly, I would like to thank Dr. Susie Lingam for very generously sponsoring this event. There is I would have had this, but it's Sam. I love Sam. Singapore, I miss Sam. We miss you. Sorry, I'm going to say that. So, I thought I would say something about this exhibition, you know, on behalf of my sponsors, but also because I find it very moving and I love museums. And I think what this speaks of is about how important flights of imagination are, voyages,